Right, so this unit is going to be a quick revision on international politics. Now, when I say quick revision, it's going to be like, you know, if you remember, we took like two theory classes to finish this area, but I will be covering a quick revision on this unit within like 1 hour, okay? So the first thing you need to understand is that there is a difference between national politics and international politics, right? So when you take national politics, we are looking at the normal politics that you are familiar with. You have a state. State is the central authority, central organization, whereas like you have things like the government, which is the practical hand of the state. And then there are political parties, there are politicians, elections, and so forth, like basically what you are normally familiar with as politics. But when you take international politics, it's a different process. You don't have like a centralized figure. You don't have political parties. You don't have a power struggle. International politics is more of a coordination process, right? So the best example that you can think of, right? The best example that you can understand is how a family works, how a family works, and how a neighboring situation works. Right now, if you take a family for example, right, you take a family for example, a family lives inside a house, right, inside a home. So inside the family, that you have some person who is in charge of, you know, making all the decisions. There's a proper hierarchy. You know who is in charge. You know who are the subjects and all that, right? But if you take like let's say an apartment complex, right? If you take an apartment complex and how people would work together as neighbors, it's different. Like you have different families and there is a coordination process. Okay. Now, I haven't finished this textbook yet thus far because of that I don't have any pictures in it. But if I explain it to you, let me show you. Right. So it's if you take a family, right? If you take a family like this, it's basically, you know, that you have a father and a mother and you have children. So obviously that, you know, this, it's revolving around one person. The father makes a decision. Children are under them. There are proper rules that you know who is in charge of whom, who has the authority and all that. This is like national politics, that you have the state. State is revolving around like the others are revolving around the state, and you have a proper hierarchy. There is a way that you work in a family. But this is like more like neighbors, international politics, like between, it's a matter of communicating between these two, maintaining relations between these two houses. These two houses don't have like one central authority controlling. These people have authority in their house. These people have authority in their house. Now it's a matter of these two houses coordinating with each other and sort of like handling the challenges they face together. So even if you look at international politics, it's pretty much the same thing, right? That means that national politics means what's going on inside a country. International politics means how countries in the world work together with each other. Now, obviously, back in the day, there was not much anything called international politics because there was no globalization and the countries were pretty much isolated from one another. What a country did didn't really matter to the other country. But now it's different. Now you have a system where, you know, what a country does really matters to another country and countries working together. So we have an international community. So international politics is like a coordination process between separate countries where they don't have like a state or a government or a centralized figure. Okay. Then if you go through this textbook, there is an explanation of how this was developed. There's interstate relations, how states work with one another, and international organizations, when states get together to form organizations like the UN or the Commonwealth or the SAARC or whatever, and international laws. Sometimes that there are laws which decide how a country should work in the international community, right? So just go through this, and then there's defining international politics. You have a couple of definitions given by different scholars, right? Anyways, we'll skip them for now because we are doing a quick revision. And there is a specific note on what are the differences between national and international politics. Now, first of all, when it comes to politics, right? It should be politics, huh? Not conflicts. Let's typo here. If you have the printed version, just correct it. So when you look at difference between national and international politics, basically, politics is like a power struggle between different parties. Now, when you take national politics, it's always a power struggle which revolves around the state. But international politics, that's also a power struggle. But it's more of a system where countries are more like working together, but the power struggle is not revolving around a particular state. Okay. Then in first difference you have is in national politics and international politics, you have different players, different actors. Right? So normally in national politics, who are the main roles? Political parties, politicians, citizens who are the ones who are voting, right? So other than that, in international politics, the main roles are played by sovereign states. Other than that, there are things like international organizations, multinational companies, influential individuals, what is not mentioned is terrorist groups. They also can be key roles. But national politics is different. You have political parties, politicians, governments, and all those things work. Okay. Of course, you know, national politics is very organized and very structured, that you know that you have a proper system. You have a state, you have a government. The government is based on either the cabinet format or the presidential format, that you know who is the president, who is in the parliament and all that. But national politics, you don't necessarily have like a proper structure. Now, if you live in an apartment, think of it inside your house, you have a properly well-structured family. You know that your father is there as a decision maker, that, you know this room belongs to this person. Your mother gets to make certain decisions. Like maybe you have like a deadline that what time you should come home. Like if you want to do something, have a sleepover, or like bring a friend over, you know where to take your permission from, right? But the thing about the apartment complex, like how you all work with your neighbors, there is no proper structure like that. Like just the people in the houses get together and they make a collective decision. That's all. Then national politics basically mean politics inside the state, right? International politics means that politics outside the state territories, like basically how the state handles their affairs with other states, right? You have the behavior of national political stakeholders. Now, this is normally controlled by the government and ethics, where the national politics always connected to. So because of that, national politics are most of the times peaceful, right? Unless you have like really bad ethnic tension, a bit like racism or stuff like that, normally national politics is peaceful. That's because like the state, you have the sovereign authority called the state to prevent any violence from happening. In fact, they can use legitimate violence against the people who cause trouble in the society. Right? You can't go and for two political parties just go on the streets and start killing each other because the police is going to come and stop them. So because of that, national politics is most of the times peaceful. But since international politics, there's no supreme authority, a state with a legitimate violence with the power to stop. It's most of the times international politics can be very violent. Most of the times they can go to war. Because imagine inside Sri Lanka, if two political parties decide to go to war, the state is there to stop that from happening, to make sure that there's law and order. But in international politics, if two countries decide to go to war, there is no state to stop them from going to war. You only have the UN, but UN doesn't have powers like the UN doesn't have the powers like the state to prevent wars like that. UN does their best, but they are not supreme like the like a sovereign state, right? Then national politics always function in a sovereign state under the rule of a government. But of course, in international politics, that you necessarily don't have a government like that. So there is no rule. There is no authority. You don't, when two countries work together, there is no supreme power. Now, inside your house, your parents have a supreme power where you all are subjected to. But when neighbors work together, you don't necessarily have a supreme authority controlling like that. It's just people getting together and working together. So it's like that. Think of it in a global perspective. Also, power transformation in international, in national politics, most of the times power transition happens with elections, right? Normally, you have an election, you choose a different ruler, the rulers you have at the moment, they may lose and all that. But in international politics, power transformation are done by wars, like, which is why you have the Afghan war, the Iraqi war, the Gulf war, the Vietnam war, whatever. The wars are happening because when two countries get in conflict, most of the time it leads up to a war because there is no sovereign authority to stop that, which is why we normally say national politics depend on ballots while international politics depends on bullets. That's just a saying. Okay. Right. So other than that, there is a book which was written by Ian Clark called The Great Division in Political Science, and another book called Globalization and International Relations Theory, which was published in 1999. So Ian Clark was one of the main people who recognized these differences between national and international politics. Right. So those are the differences. Now we are moving on to state actors and non-state actors. Okay. First of all, who are the actors in international politics? They are completely different from the actors in national politics. Who are the actors in national politics in Sri Lanka? Right. You have political parties. Podu Jana Peramuna, Samugi Jana Balavegeya, Jatik Jana Balavege, JVP, UNP, SLFP, Muslim Congress, what do you call, the Tamil National Alliance, and all those political parties. But you don't have those actors in international politics. You have in national politics, you have political parties, politicians, even us. We ourselves, we play a part in national politics because we are the voters. Depending on our vote, a lot of things are decided. So we play a part in national politics. But in international politics, we are insignificant, pretty much. We have nothing to do with that. Political parties have nothing to do with that. Political persons have nothing to, politicians have nothing to do with that. Because international politics depend on different, completely different actors. Okay. So before we get into those actors, we need to understand there are two types of actors in international politics. First of all, you have the state actors. And secondly, you have non-state actors. Okay. So let's take one by one. First, let's look at the state actors. So who are the state actors we have? State actors, of course, there are two state actors. First, the nation states themselves. So practically states, countries. Countries themselves, we have, depending on the source you check, we have like nearly 200 countries in the world. If you ask the UN, it will be 193. If you consider all the dispute territories and that, it will be 206, right? So anyways, we have a lot of countries in the world. So those countries, nation states, are the very first actor and they are the main actor. This is technically, this is a process between the countries in the world. Okay, so that's a first actor. States, the countries themselves. Then what is the second main actor? Well, like who is the second main actor? Interstate organization. That means that first of all, first actor we have are countries themselves. Then secondly, if there are countries who have got together to form an organization, they are the second type of actors here, right? Countries or countries getting together and making organizations. Right, so there are different kinds of state organizations you have, right? There are regional organizations, there are global organizations, and there are medium organizations. So regional, global means if the organization involves all the countries in the world, all the countries in the world, global organizations. Or you have regional organizations where like certain countries in a certain area belong to that. Or there are medium organizations, like not exactly limited to a region, but they are not like so expanded throughout the world. Okay. For example, you can see SAARC, South Asian Association for Regional Cooperation. That's SAARC, only South Asian area. European Union, that's another organization. Only due around the European area, right? Okay, so that those are like regional organizations, right? SAARC, European Union, only in a particular region. Then United Nations is a global organization because that's they are all over the world. Every country in the world is a part of it. If you take like the Commonwealth and all that, those are like medium organizations because it's not exactly limited to a certain area, neither spread throughout the world. So normally they say that you need more than 3 member states to start an international organization, interstate organization, interstate, right? You need at least 3 countries to form one of these organizations. Okay. Interstate organization. What is the unique thing about these organizations? Only countries can be members. Can you go and become a member in the SAARC? No. Sri Lanka can be a member of SAARC. Can you go and become a member of the UN? You can go volunteer with the UN. You can go do a job in UN. You can't get the UN membership. Right? United Nations membership is only given to countries. SAARC membership is only given to countries. European nation, European Union. A membership is only given to countries. So interstate organizations, organizations created by states getting together. So what are the 2 state-related actors you have in international politics? Number one, states themselves, countries themselves, countries. Those are the main actors. Other than that, if there are organizations created by countries getting together, either countries in a region like SAARC or European Union, or countries all around the world like the UN, or like somewhere in between like the Commonwealth. Okay, right. Let's take a look at what are the non-state actors. What are the non-state actors? Actually, you have an explanation about like all these organizations, like a detailed explanation. So you can watch this. You can read this and you can watch the detailed explanation I've uploaded to this channel. All right, so what are the non-state actors? What are the... who are the actors in international politics that states are not connected? Countries are not connected. What are those? First of all, non-governmental organizations, INGOs. So basically, they are like non-governmental, like government are not like private ran organizations, non-governmental, and they are international, like Rotary, Lions Club and all that, but like the most important one is the Red Cross, right? The Red Cross internationally is considered as the oldest international organization in the world, which was formed in 1863 in Geneva. Okay, so their motive is like helping people who are like affected by the war. Okay, and they work on human rights as well, Red Cross. So there are international non-governmental organizations. States are not connected, right? You need to understand the difference between interstate organizations and international non-governmental organizations. What is the difference between UN and Red Cross? UN, you have to be a country to be a member. Red Cross, countries are not members. Sri Lanka is not a member in the Red Cross. No, country, no. People become members. I have an aunt who is a member of the Red Cross, who is in Israel and Palestine, like, you know, helping those people out. Okay, like that. So those are the international non-governmental organizations. They are actors of this international politics. And then, of course, MNCs, multinational corporations or transnational corporations. These are the commercial organizations, like companies. Right, so they are multinational. Why? They are not like companies which is only there in one country. Right, it's not like a brand like you know, maybe like Kotmale Milk or like Kotmale Milk or Kissed Jam or something like that. You know, those companies are only there in Sri Lanka. Now look at these examples: Coca-Cola, Pepsi, Microsoft, Apple, Samsung, Google, Facebook, Nestle, McDonald's, Adidas, Nike, Toyota, General Motors, Qatar Airways, Sony, Unilever, right? These companies are multinational. They are in pretty much a lot of countries. So because of this, they also play a major role in international politics, because these companies are necessary. Now, I remember once Donald Trump wanted to pass a law against, like, you know, people from to prevent people from, like, Iraq, Iran, Somalia, Syria, Sudan. He wanted to prevent these Muslim people from coming to the US from these countries. And companies like Samsung, Facebook, Apple, they threatened to pull out from the US. So Trump sort of had to renew his laws, right? So that shows that these multinational companies also have a very big influence over international politics. They practically control the economic aspect of the world. Okay. Then, of course, influential personalities, eminent persons. Now, you guys know, of course, individual persons have no control, no influence over international politics, not like national politics. In international politics, single people in the sense like individual people don't really matter, right? What matters is like either entire countries or like organizations created by countries or like private organizations that are like big enough in the entire globe or like companies that are like have like business all around the world. But other than that, there are some individual personalities, because of the influence, the global influence these people have, they are also considered somewhat important in international politics. Now, for example, certain political leaders, right? So if you are a leader of a country, if you are a leader of a country and your country is very powerful, then there is an impact. Now, example, when Donald Trump was the president in the US, he was influential. Vladimir Putin in Russia, Kim Jong-un in North Korea, Narendra Modi in India, right? Xi Jinping in China, right? Even like people like Gandhi from India. You don't have to be the leader of the country per se. You may be a political leader and you may have an impact all around the world, very influential. So you have an impact. You are an actor in international politics as well, because you can change something. Just being a president doesn't matter, right? You know, our president Gotabe Rajapaksa is insignificant in international politics, although he is prominent in national politics. Given that Sri Lanka is a weak country and in international politics we have no influence, he's not an influential personality. Okay? And in a country like that, you necessarily don't have to be the president to be influential. For example, Donald Trump is somewhat influential still in international politics, although he's not the president anymore. Okay? Point is that you have to be a political leader where you have an influence over the people. Then, of course, if you are a leader of an international organization, if you are the general secretary of the UN, if you are like a big position in the Commonwealth, that then also you may have an influence, right? Or as like religious leaders, like the Pope, or the Dalai Lama, or Ayatollah Al-Khomeini, who's in Iran, okay, those people, or business leaders. Right? Religious leaders are very powerful because they have a big following because of the religious basis they have. Or like business people like Donald Trump, Mark Zuckerberg, Jeff Bezos, Richard Branson, right? So these people have an influence because of the financial strength they have. Steve Jobs, of course, not there anymore. Bill Gates, these people. And recently, because of the social media and all, and the fact that the celebrities have a social media following, they have been capable of influencing people through social media. Now, for example, Black Lives Matter, how it became so important, how it became so significant, because of support it received from celebrities. Now, you see Cristiano Ronaldo, Oprah Winfrey, Beyonce, Dwayne Johnson, Will Smith, Ellen, right? These people have become quite significant as a result of the social media and the support that they have, right? So other than that, there is another important actor in international politics. Given that we are talking about actors, roles, we are talking about the villain here, terrorist groups, right? So you have terrorist groups, and currently we have like terrorist groups sort of threatening global protection, global security, especially with the rise of ISIS Al-Qaeda, Taliban, and all these terrorist groups, right? So back in the day, terrorist groups was a domestic problem. Countries had national issues like India, Sri Lanka, Pakistan. We had terrorist issues within our countries, also African countries. Some of those Slavic countries and all those countries had some terrorist issues within the states. It was never an international problem. But in 2001, with September 11 attacks on the New York City, with like Osama bin Laden and all that, we realized that terrorism had become a global threat now. So because of that, the terrorist groups pose such a threat on international politics. Now, for example, Turkey had been trying to take membership of the European Union for so long. But one of the reasons that they are not given European Union membership is because they share a border with Syria. And Syria has a lot of ISIS people. And European Union does not want to have a country in the European Union which shares a border with a country that has a lot of ISIS terrorists, right? So I guess you can see that international political decisions have been influenced because of these terrorist groups. And this is a recent development. And these terrorist groups actually have a huge impact on politics, international politics. Of course, like I included a very extensive note, detailed note about how terrorism became more influential. And how during the Cold War time, USA and Soviet Union both helped these small terrorist groups, and how it sort of evolved into a bigger problem, right? Other than that, there are a couple of new trends that we need to look into that in addition to those state and non-state actors, there are some new trends which has allowed more actors to come in. Environmental problems like global warming, water security, water scarcity, air pollution, water pollution. These things have allowed more activists to become more influential in international politics. If you remember Greta, that Swedish girl, right? One of her videos went out, like she wasn't a celebrity, she wasn't an eminent person before, but these problems have created a platform for new actors to come in. And of course, there are natural disasters like droughts, earthquakes, floods, and all that, famines, and all these problems. Of course, the epidemics like HIV, AIDS, Ebola, and global pandemics like COVID-19. So, because the current world is facing a lot of issues, and these issues are not national problems anymore, any of these problems, right, in this list, global warming, air pollution, water pollution, these natural disasters, HIV, AIDS, Ebola, COVID, none of these are like problems faced by solitary countries. These are problems faced by the entire globe. So because of that, international politics have been much more important, because the entire world needs to have an approach to handle these problems. And because of that, more and more new actors have been coming and taking part in international politics. Right.
So I have a question.
Yes, go ahead.
So what about Interpol? Do they have influence?
Interpol. Okay, Interpol does not necessarily have like, they have a global influence, but they don't really impact the international politics per se. Okay, because what they do is they just arrest criminals and they try to keep the law and order going. So they do have an international influence, but they hardly change anything. Like if the, let's say USA is about to make a decision, right? Any of these players, any of these actors can stop. Now imagine Donald Trump is about to make a certain decision, right? International non-governmental organizations may get involved and stop them from doing that, okay? Multinational companies may get involved and they would stop USA from making a certain decision. Eminent persons like these religious leaders, political leaders, celebrities, they may get involved and they may stop something from happening like that. Terrorist groups, like, you know, they make certain things happen. Right? They have stopped Turkey from getting the European Union membership. So these people have an influence. They can change how things work in international politics. Something like Interpol, they can't really change what these countries would do. Understand? That's why we don't consider them to be a role or a player or an actor in international politics. Okay? Right. So national power and national interest. Now, there are a couple of things you need to understand here is that national interest is what a country would desire. And national power means like the capacity the country has to achieve what they desire. Simple as that. National interest is what you want. National power is your capacity to achieve those. But think of countries as individuals. Now, as people, everyone has very similar interests, right? We all like to have a good meal. We all like to have shelter. We all like to have a nice family. We all like to be loved. We all like to have a nice vehicle, like to dress up all nice, a good salary, a stable future, right? A good friends. And those are the things that people like. People have similar common interests. But the capacity we have to achieve those are different. Right? Some people can afford a vehicle. Some people get gifts. Some people get vehicles as gifts. Right? Some people can collect money and buy one. Some people have to take a loan or a lease and buy one and pay a big amount. For some people, it's just a dream. You always just look at other people driving vehicles and you never get one. Right? For some people, like even going in a bus is difficult. Right? Some people, if you've seen that movie, Machang, right? So in that, if you remember the guy after coming from the embassy after applying for visa to go for a job in Europe, he comes home in the garbage truck because the garbage truck people are his friends and he takes a lift from them, right? So everyone likes to have like a nice vehicle and a nice house. And so, as I told you, some people own like 4 or 5 houses. Some people get houses like inherited. Some people have to buy one, collect money and buy one. Some people have to like take a loan and get a house. And some people have to stay in rented houses. Some people don't even have like a proper shelter. Some people live under bridges. So everyone likes to have a house and a vehicle and a good meal and a nice family. But people have different capacities to achieve those. So if you think of countries, countries are also like that. All the countries have very similar interests. So if you look at what are those, right? These are the interests every country has in common, right? Assuring national security, developing national economy, improving national welfare, establishing national morale, protecting national political ideologies, right? So these things are actually common to all the countries. Every country likes to have a good security, assure their security, or like improve their economy or improve their welfare, make sure that they have good morale and to protect whatever the ideologies they have. But it's a matter of what sort of a capacity they have. That's what you call the national power, the capacity they have to achieve. The capacity they have to achieve whatever the country's interests are. Okay. So, right. So because of that, we can see different countries follow different mechanisms to achieve what they desire. Okay, so let's see what are the strategies they follow to achieve what they desire. First of all, diplomacy. Diplomacy means working with another country, right? Following diplomatic relations, handling, maintaining a good rapport, like a friendship with other countries. That's what you mean by diplomacy. Then propaganda. You like to do propaganda, do some promotional work, marketing work for your country to show that, you know, your country is doing all fine. Then economic aid. Countries like to help other countries in finances. Now, China is a country that does this. And China gives a lot of financial aiding to other countries so that they can maintain a good relation with that country, which ultimately helps them because they have a big feud going on with the US, right? Then getting into alliances and getting into agreements. So for example, NATO. NATO was created because during the Cold War times, like the Western bloc of the countries, Western European countries and USA and Canada and those North Atlantic countries, they sort of had like a conflict going on. So they wanted to look more stronger in terms of security. They established NATO. That means if one of the NATO countries get attacked, all the other countries will come to the aid, which protects their security more, right? Then, of course, coercive means. This is practically force, right? This is based on force, like sending troops. Sometimes when a country can't get what they desire, they use military force. Okay. USA wanted to stop the spread of communism. So they forcefully entered into Vietnam because Vietnam was trying to be communist. Okay. Like that. Okay. So these are the ways, these are the methods that they follow to achieve whatever the country desires. Now let's see what are the factors which decides the strength of a country. Power of a country. Sometimes we use the word, we refer the word saying this country is a strong country. What makes a country really strong? First of all, natural elements, geographical elements, right? Sometimes like in certain situations, some geographical situations are quite bad. Some geographical locations are good. For example, Sri Lanka is in a bad position because we are right under the nose of India. So which has sort of put us in a position where we have to always we take decisions with the best interest of India. We can't keep India in bad books, right? For example, during the World War times, Poland, Belgium, Netherlands, they all suffered from invasion. Why? Because their neighbor countries are Germany, France, and Britain, all the countries who were involved in the war, right? So when the French or the Germans had to invade the other country, most of the times troops went through their countries, Belgium, Netherlands. And sometimes even Poland had to get caught in the crossfire. Right? Comparing to that, Switzerland managed to survive the war because Switzerland was surrounded by mountains where invading Switzerland was impossible. Other than that, during the entire Europe was in like this heat of the World War, Portugal and Spain was least affected because they were at the corner of Europe and they were open to the Atlantic Ocean and they managed their ties with the rest of the world, and they just went ahead without any problem. Okay, so another example, now India has Himalayas, right? So because that China may threaten to India saying they are going to invade them, but because of the Himalayas, there's like a wall, there's like a natural fort that they have, and that gives them protection. Okay, so when you have a large territory like USA, China, Brazil, first of all, that it's easier to face invasions because your invader has to cover a lot of ground. Okay, now for a country like Sri Lanka, practically maybe the Chinese army can easily invade our entire country because they have so many people in China, so many soldiers in the Chinese army, that they can send a huge number of soldiers to each district without any problem. But if you want to invade India, it's not that easy. India is a big country in terms of territory, and it's not easy for an army. On the other hand, we normally consider a country being too big is also a problem because there's too much of border you need to protect then. Because your army is also not enough to protect your own country. So in that way, we normally prefer having a moderate size is better, right? It's not too big, that's not difficult to defend the borders, and it's not too small, an enemy army can't invade your country. Okay. Also things like the weather, right? Now, Russia was invaded twice by two really powerful men, one time by Napoleon, the French invasion, second time by Hitler with the German Nazi invasion. Both times Russia managed to win the war because of the geographical situation, because of the winter, because the Russian winter is not manageable to any other invader, right? So they can't survive in Russia when the cold comes. Or even USA being such a powerful country, they couldn't win the Vietnam War because the Vietnam forests were a different territory for the US soldiers, and the Viet Cong soldiers were much more powerful in that. So natural elements comes first. That's the first reason that makes a country strong. Other than that, scientific and technological elements, like you need to have the technology, you need to have the science behind you if you want to really be powerful as a country. Okay. Now, most of the South, most of the African countries have the issue, like they have resources and raw materials, but the problem is they don't have the science and the technology to make use of those raw materials. Otherwise, Africa is a very, very rich continent. Now, for example, Japan. Japan does not have raw material. That's one of the problems. Japan is a very dull country in terms of raw material. They pretty much have nothing. But Japan is such a powerful and developed country in the world. It's because that they have the technology to make use of whatever the raw material they have and whatever the raw material they bring from other countries. So science and technology is the main reason that Japan has been so powerful in the international community. Another factor is the population. Now, you take population also into consideration. Having a too large population is a problem because, now, first of all, if you have a large population, that would create a bigger labor force that you can work in your country. On the other hand, that you have more people to recruit to your military also. But on the other hand, when you have too many people, that would give you more mouths to feed, right? So because of that, like, resources can run out. On the other hand, if you have a small population, it's not going to be that costly to sustain your population. But of course, there is another problem of your workforce, your workforce and your military being too small. So what is normally recommended is having a population that is moderate, not too much, not too small, just like the territory. Okay. Right. Then, of course, political elements. In terms of political elements, for a country to be powerful, you have to make sure that what sort of a government you have, right? For example, if your country is like very rich in resources, you have all the geographical necessities and you have all the science and all those requirements. But even if your country is politically, your regime, the regime that governs the country is corrupted and the bureaucracy is too corrupted, and if the democratic standards are down, that is going to affect the country. It's going to sort of affect the morale of the country. And because of that, the country is not going to be too powerful. This is the problem with most of the South American countries and Central American countries like Argentina, Chile, Peru. Those countries are actually, they have the resources and raw material and geographical factors, everything. But most of the regimes in power in those countries are very corrupted. That leaves a problem. And these countries don't end up being powerful countries. Then, of course, social and ideological elements. Now, different countries promote different values. Okay, so as a result of that, depending on what your country promotes. Now, for example, the Soviet Union having that much of resources and the potential, they ended up collapsing because they went ahead with the communist ideology, right? And of course, Germany following the fascist ideology. So different countries follow different ideologies. And that also has an impact on whether your country becomes, whether your state becomes powerful or not. Okay. Right. Then there are other elements, certain elements, how popular the country is, the quality of your military, the efficiency of your civil service, right? Self-awareness, education levels of the country, the people and all those things. Those things also depend on, those things also are influential when it comes to the power of a country. Okay. Right. Then we are moving on to the new trends in international politics. Right. So let's see what are the new trends in international politics. Now, contemporary international politics, what's happening right now. So when I was teaching you guys this in the theory class also, I told you like there are three recent trends that you need to study. And out of these three trends, actually only the first one is the advanced one that you need to have an idea. Third one and the second one are very similar to one another and not that complex. Starting off with the first one, multipolar power balance system. Now, this polar system, we are talking about how many countries are powerful in the world at the moment. How many countries are sort of running the show in international politics. This is a little similar to the political party system we studied in the second unit, like it's not similar in terms of the concept, but like from a theoretical perspective, the structure of this concept is a little similar. Right? If you remember, in second unit we studied, if the system only has one part, it's a one-party system. If there are like many parties and only two parties are powerful, then it's a two-party system. More than two parties are powerful, it's a multi-party system, right? Here also it's the same. So it's a matter of whether how many countries are sort of powerful and influential in the system. If there's only one country who's running the entire thing, entire show, it's a unipolar power balance system. If there are two countries who are like extremely powerful and the other countries are sort of tailing up behind them, it's a two-party. It's a bipolar power balance system. Bipolar power balance system. Unipolar, bipolar. And if there are more than two countries, many nations, sort of like sharing the global dominance and all of them are somewhat powerful working together, that's it's a multipolar power balance system. So what you need to understand here is the timeline, how things worked out, okay? So international politics initially became a thing in the 20th century. As I told you, before that, international politics was not a thing because there was no globalization, technology, transportation, everything was quite primitive. So people hardly sort of like traveled. And because of that, countries were isolated from one another. So in the 20th century, only what a country does started being mattered to others. So by this time, in the earlier stage of 20th century, Europeans were pretty much ruling the entire world. These European nations like Britain, the British, French, the Italians, the Germans, the Dutch, Portuguese, even the Belgians. Now, these different European nations sort of owned different land area in the world because they had colonized pretty much the entire globe at this time. So because of that, we started off our international politics with a multipolar power balance system. We had the British, who had pretty much the most of the dominating force at that time because they had the most number of colonies at that time. Pretty much the entire Asia was colonized by the British. French were also somewhat powerful. They also had some territories in Asia, and most of the African countries were colonized by them. And there were other European nations as well. So it started off with a multipolar power balance system. And then we started having a world war. In fact, we started having a world war because of the multipolar system. Because all the countries are powerful, there was like a talk going, and they had this problem of proving which country was superior, which ended up like leading all these countries going into the First World War and eventually the Second World War, right? So after the Second World War, you guys know that the World War was fought against the Germans. German Nazis, and there were like five countries who fought together, the US, British, Soviet Union, and France and China. Well, France and China were like, China had their own battle going on with Japan, and France actually fell to Germany. It was a matter of like, they didn't play that much of a key role. The main three roles were handled by the US, Britain, and Soviet Union. So after the war ended, they were together, but given the fact that Soviet Union followed communism and Britain and US, especially the US, followed liberal capitalism, they had an ideological difference. So because of that, they realized both these countries were extremely powerful, which means that US, Britain, and other Western European countries were following liberal capitalism. And in addition, in comparison, the Eastern European countries and the Soviet Union, they were following socialism. So we sort of went into a bipolar power balance system where USA and the Western European countries, Western bloc, they were following liberalism, and Eastern bloc countries and Soviet Union, they were following socialism. So during this time, after 1940s, 50s, 60s, 70s, during this time, the world was in a bipolar system, typical bipolar system. It was a matter of choosing whether you are with the US or whether you are with the Soviet Union. Now, we saw normally in countries when they get like regimes, some regimes preferred the US, some regimes preferred the Soviet Union, except for some countries, like even in Ceylon, people like SWRD Bandaranaike, countries like Yugoslavia, Ghana, these countries sort of preferred saying non-aligned. That means like we don't want to sort of like join either of them. Like, we want to stay independent. So except for them, most of the countries stayed up with one of these two countries. So you guys are aware that the Cold War between these two countries, Cold War means like no one really actually fought a war. USA and Soviet Union never really fought a war. In fact, they got involved in other wars, proxy wars going on around the world. Like for example, in Vietnam, it was a fight between the Viet Congs and the Vietnamese army. So the US aided the Vietnamese army and Soviets helped the Viet Congs. Now, even in Sri Lanka, lucky that our war started in the 1980s. It's ironic that I say lucky during a time that a war was started. But if Sri Lankan war, civil war, was started around like 1960s, USA and Soviet Union would have got involved, right? Now, if the Sri Lankan civil war started in 1960s, where Dudley Senalaika was in power, that Dudley Senalaika's government was UNP, and that was a pro-American, pro-Western government. So in that case, the US would have helped the government troops, and the Soviet Union would have helped the LTT, right? The other way around, the war happened in the 1970s, because in the 70s, what we had was a socialist-oriented government. If the war occurred during the 70s, the Soviet Union would have helped the government troops and the US would have helped the LTT. So this is what was going on all around the world. Like everywhere inside a country where there was a war, Soviet Union helped one side and the US helped the other side. This is what you call proxy wars, right? So this was going on for a long time. And by 1980s, obviously, with the economic struggle, Soviet Union fell. And it looked as if, mark this word, it looked as if world was going to a unipolar power balance system. Everyone thought, okay, Soviet Union is no more having any power, which means that we are definitely going to a unipolar power balance system. That means USA would be the sole authority of power. But it didn't turn out to be that way, because we saw a couple of other entities coming up. Okay. We saw several other entities coming up. For example, the rise of China, right? The rise of China as an economic giant didn't leave the USA to be the only superpower in the world. Other than that, European countries, given the European countries weren't having the best time, European countries decided to work together and they established the European Union, right? And they also became very powerful, right? Other than that, rise of Middle Eastern countries discovered that they had oil, which gave them like an insane amount, ridiculous amount of money. So they became like financially very powerful. Then the Southeast Asian countries, Singapore, Malaysia, Thailand, Cambodia, these countries used to be like farmland back in the day, but they sort of like they created this ASEAN and they developed their countries as tourist destinations, where they also became like a financial hub. Countries like Singapore, Malaysia, they also became strong. Then European countries started working together. And then, of course, rise of the BRICS countries. BRICS means Brazil, Russia, India, China, South Africa. These countries also have been working together and they also have like very rapidly developing economies. So because of that, although we thought that the bipolar system is over and we are sort of like having a unipolar system hereafter, it wasn't the case. USA could not dominate world politics. As you can see, so many other entities are coming up. So we went right back into a multipolar power balance system. And as a result, we are currently in a multipolar power balance system, right? Then we need to look into the alternative international networks. So we are practically looking at the movements, people networking together as movements, and what sort of impact that has on international politics. Now, for example, how they got rid of the Egyptian president, Hosni Mubarak, in 2011. Right, using Facebook, all the young people got together and they got rid of the Egyptian president. And following that, other Arabian countries also got the inspiration and they also started protesting against their autocratic leaders, right? And this is known as the Arab Spring, right? Arab Spring, this was started, right? 2011. Okay. So as you can see now, especially because of social media and because people networking together to be politically active, it has had like a big impact on politics, right? Also, new social movement, that's again looking at the same thing from a different perspective, like LGBT rights and all these things, Black Lives Matter and all these things, they have also received quite a lot of attention and quite a lot of influence as a result of people networking, especially using the social media platforms and all that. Okay. Right. Now that we have discussed how international politics work, let's take a quick look at how international politics have an impact on Sri Lanka. Right. Now, there's an entire unit talking about Sri Lanka and the world, which is the next unit, unit 15, last unit of the syllabus. This is like a small bridge that connects unit 14 and 15. Okay. So we have to start by acknowledging the fact that this is a globalized world we currently live in, and no state can function in isolation. There's only one state who does that, which is North Korea. And obviously they are doing pretty bad because of that. Like, you know, you have to work together with the international community. That's like an obvious thing. But given that Sri Lanka is not a very powerful country, that we have been subjected to international political and economic trends. Okay. So let's start by checking what are the economic trends. Actually, these two trends are quite similar. Now, first of all, you need to understand Sri Lanka is a small country, weak, vulnerable country. Because of that, we are not a trend maker. We are a trend follower country, right? We just follow whatever the economic trends created by other countries. And given our financial situation, we always have to depend on financial aid of a alien entity. Now, back in the day, in the 90s, we only had one way to get the economic help we needed. That was taking economic help from international organizations, right? Because there are so many international organizations that give our country loans, like the IMF, the World Bank, and all those things. But in the recent times, we of course have a different option, that we can take loans from China. But however, the thing is that when the international organizations give us aid, right? When the IMF is giving us a sum of money, they don't just give it. They give it with some, with some conditions, right? Many conditions, as you can see, free and fair elections, independent judiciary, freedom of media. Like, they check whether your country has proper independent, proper democratic standards. Then only they give the financial aid, right? So sometimes that in order to take these financial grants, we sort of have to agree into terms. Sometimes they are not like really good in terms of political independence. We have to compromise our political independency in order to take that sum of money. And that has been quite critical. A lot of political parties have been criticizing, and especially during election season, these things become very hot topics. A lot of politicians talk about, right? Another example is the GSP Plus facility. Now, this is a tax relief, right? So when Sri Lanka is importing ready-made clothes to European Union, we can actually sell them to European countries without paying taxes. That's the GSP Plus tax facility. So this was granted to Sri Lanka during early 2000s, like in 2002, while the Ranil Wickremesinghe was the prime minister of our country. So because of that, because Ranil Wickremesinghe had good connections with the European Union, they granted this tax relief to Sri Lanka, right? And when Mahinda Rajapaksha was the president of the country and he had the war going on at that time, so because of that, they sort of like took GSP Plus away on the allegations of us violating human rights. So in 2015 only, when Ranil Wickremesinghe became prime minister again, the European Union considered granting us GSP Plus. But in order to take GSP Plus again, we had to enter into 27 international conventions. Some of them were it's actually a lot controversial in Sri Lanka. And because of that, it was quite critical of that time. Right. So of course, political trends are connected to economic trends. Because of these, whatever the economic trends that the country is giving into, create very much political, political changes in the country, political conflicts of the country. That means that if a government agrees to sort of like follow certain decisions made by a certain certain, let's say China or an organization, they get criticized and they may lose the next election. So it has an impact on politics as well. Now, for example, another example is that when it comes to China rising up as a global power at the moment. So we have to keep an eye now as Sri Lanka, we have to keep an eye. We can't just maintain friendship with the USA. Why? First of all, we have our neighbor, India. We have to keep India on our good books. Then we have China, who is a regional head in Asia. We have to keep them also in our good books. Then we have to keep USA also in our good books because we need help from them also. But the political struggle that you have going on at the moment is going to be quite important. Now, you guys know it's a multipolar system we have at the moment. So as a result of that, we can't really favor now. If it's a unipolar system, if USA is single-handedly running the entire world, no problem. You just have to go behind the USA and do whatever they say, and they will give you grants, right? If it's a bipolar system, okay, USA and Soviet Union, you pick one side and you take help from them. Now, given that it's a multipolar system, USA is also powerful, India is also powerful, China is also powerful, Middle East is also powerful, Southeastern Asia is also powerful, European Union is also powerful. So because of that, you have to maintain ties with all these countries without really offending another, which has been really challenging to recent governments our country has had. Either ways, about how challenging Sri Lanka's maintenance with other countries have been, we have an entire unit, which is Sri Lanka and the World, where we will discuss the foreign policy of Sri Lanka, and we will look into it next week. Okay, right.